connection is where Babylon, Balaam, and the beast and final world religion all are connected. You say, what's going on? Pergamos is the first church that began allowing idolatry into the church. Images of saints, like St. Paul's Cathedral in New York. Any of you, or St. Patrick's Cathedral in New York, the big one. Is it Paul? It's Patrick, St. Patrick. It has every idol, every one of the saints are in there. And you can go to see St. Christopher and St. everybody. And what has happened in Roman Catholicism is that they have ascribed to the saints and to Mary the attributes of God. You say, what does that mean? Well, what's praying the rosary? It's saying, you know, Holy Mother or Mary or whatever, help me. Now, wait a minute. I'm standing inside the Tice Academic Center, and if I'm a Roman Catholic, I can take my rosary and ask Mary's help. Where is Mary? Well, she's supposedly at the right hand of the throne of Christ in heaven. But she can hear me saying my rosary in the Tice Center up there? That's saying she has omnipresence. It also says that she can hear every Roman Catholic anywhere on the planet at all times doing that. That means she's omniscient. She knows everything going on everywhere. And if she can help him, she's omnipotent. You see, what Roman paganism has done is ascribed to humans the attributes of God. How did all that start? It started here. God, his plan, has always been counterfeited by Satan. That's what Paul said. He said Satan in 2 Corinthians 11:14 is an angel of light. Satan isn't wearing red tights and having a pointy tail and a pitchfork. That is not. He is an angel of light. There was a book written by a Mormon lady, her name is Betty Eady, and it was called Embrace by the Light. And she went around and took all these interviews of people and asked them when they were on their deathbed in surgery, you know, and they're one of these people that died and then they, you know, defibrillated them and they came back. She said, what did you see? And they always said they saw this shaft of light and they saw hands saying, come. And these people were not Christians, and they were Hindus, and they were Buddhists, and they were Mormons, and they were anythings. And all of them saw the same thing at death. They saw this white, glowing, hands out saying, come, come, come. And she said, so you need to be embraced by the light. Well, what does Paul say in 2 Corinthians 11? He said, watch out, because even, verse 14, no wonder, for Satan himself transforms him into an angel of light. And so Satan's goal is to counterfeit the truth. If I wanted to make fake money, you know, I wouldn't make a red $20 bill. Would you take a red $20 bill from me? You go, no, I don't want that. It's fake. It's not supposed to be red. It's supposed to be green. Counterfeiters get as close as they can to the real thing. The real danger your generation is going to have, I'm glad that you're at Word of Life, because most people in most churches cannot defend what they believe. Now, they know, they have their hero, you know, whoever their pastor is, and they'll go, well, whatever he says, you know, that's what I believe. But they can't, from the scriptures, defend what they believe. And that is a danger because Satan doesn't give out red $20 bills. He gives out green ones. He counterfeits by just slightly. Do you know what rat poison, you know, when you have mice in your house and you go down and get poison for the mice and put it out, you know, in your attic or something, do you know what it is? It's 99% point something good grain, like wheat. But they just put 0.2% rat poison. Coumadin actually is what they use on them, which makes them bleed. And those poor rats bleed to death in your walls and they shrink and shrivel up and they're gone. But how do they get them? They have 99 point whatever percent good grain with poison. That's what Satan does. He takes a lot of truth and just adds that layer of error. Jesus said there's only two choices, only two destinations in Matthew 7. There's the broad gate, which many are on, and the narrow gate that few find. Jesus was very negative about the visible church. He says in Matthew 7, many will say unto me in that day, Lord, Lord, weren't we in church? And he says, yeah, you were, but I never knew you personally. Depart from me. In fact, the worst four words in the Bible are, I never knew you. You've heard of four-letter words? There are four words that are the worst. I, Jesus said, never knew you. That's why Paul says in 2 Corinthians 13:5, examine yourself whether you're in the faith. Make sure you're really a Christian. So that begins with Satan's counterfeit. There are many people that are deceived by false doctrine. Genesis 4 contrasts Satan's follower, Cain, with God's follower, Abel. Cain gave his works. Abel offered by faith what God asked for. Cain gave his best produce. Abel said, God wants me to sacrifice a substitute, an animal, shed its blood. And it said God was pleased with Abel's offering, and God was displeased with Cain's offering. And that's the two divisions. It's the religion of the world is human achievement. I'm going to go to Mecca, the Muslims say. I'm going to do the sacraments, the Catholics say. I'm going to knock on doors, the Jehovah's Witnesses say. I'm going to be good and go for 2 years wearing a white shirt, the Mormons say. And it's human achievement. That's Cain's religion. God's revelation is what Abel said, divine accomplishment. I need a substitute. I need to kill an animal in my place. I can't save myself. I'm never good enough. Only doing what God says works. That's what Abel did. And that's the difference. So Satan's religion is the wicked way of Cain. In fact, in your Bible, if you want to see something fascinating, look at 1 John 3. Did you know there's not a single person mentioned in 1 John except one person? Have you ever thought about that? When you read the Bible through and through and through, you start noticing things. 1 John chapter 3, verse 12 says this. It says, let me find chapter 3, there we go. Not as, and there's the first person mentioned in the whole epistle, Cain, who was of that wicked one and murdered his brother. And why did he murder him? Because his works were evil and his brothers were righteous. Why is Cain mentioned? Because Cain is so important. Cain grew up seeing the same thing Abel did. Cain grew up seeing those cherubim with their flaming swords guarding the way to the Garden of Eden. His parents had been thrown out. God put angels there to not let him go back in. Every day when Cain and Abel were playing, they'd get up there and they'd watch those flaming cherubs and they'd go home and say, could you tell us that story again, Mom and Dad, what happened? Well, we were in the garden and we were perfect and following the Lord, and then your mother, and Adam went on and on, and Eve said, yeah, but you did it too, and so they, but Cain and Abel both were right there in the presence of all that God was doing. And Cain rejected what he knew was true. And Abel accepted what he knew was true. And that's what 1 John, the whole book, is about. The contrast between light and darkness and right and wrong. And so that's what the Lord does.